Well, you know, it all begins right now. It's all going to begin. You know the theme. Look at all those red caps. Make America great again. Make America great again. And we can do it. And we can do it. And we're going to do it. And we're going to. So, on June escalator, I talked about illegal immigration. Everyone went crazy. What a horrible thing to discuss. 2 weeks later, everybody was saying, you know, Trump is right. And you had the killing of Kate in San Francisco. You had so many things happen. Jameel, great Jameel in Los Angeles, a phenomenal female, a wonderful woman, a vet, 65 years old, who was killed by an illegal immigrant, raped, sodomized, killed. We have problems, folks, and we have to solve our problems. And some people say, you're very divisive. You're very divisive. What's divisive? They want me to be politically correct. They don't want me to talk about the problems. They don't want me to talk about. And I do talk about them. And a lot of people are now coming up to me and saying, you're right. You're so right. I brought up a problem, radical Islamic terrorism. I brought it up. People went crazy. How could you say, we have a problem. This is a worldwide problem. And when I brought it up, people said, it's not politically correct. Don't do it. Advisors, people right back there, they said, don't do it. But you know what? People respect that I did it. And friends of mine who are Muslim called me up and they said, Donald, thank you. It's a problem. It's got to be discussed. We have a president that won't discuss the subject. He won't talk about it. And you're not going to solve the problem if you don't want to admit what the problem is. So it began, and I started with the borders. And you know Sheriff Joe from Arizona, he's like a great guy. He endorsed me last week. And he endorsed me, and let me tell you, he's a tough guy at the border, that's one thing. And he said, Trump is the toughest at the border. But I don't want to just be tough. We want to be smart. We want people to come into our country, but they have to come into our country legally, right? Legally. They go through a process, they come in, and we've got to take great people. We want great people to come in. We don't want people pouring across the border like now. I got to know, I was in Laredo, Texas, and I got to know, I was invited by our tremendous people that work the border, the Border Patrol people. These are tremendous people. These are people that want to do their job. They called me because they're not allowed to do their job. They're standing, they're great, they're wonderful, they have wonderful equipment, everything's fine, and they're told, stand back. And people walk right through the border. Why? Why? And you know, it's interesting. It's very unfair to people that do legally go through the process. You have people that are waiting for years to get in, and they're going up a list, and they've worked hard, and they've studied hard, and they want to come in. They want to be proud people coming into our country. And those people are being held back by others that come in legally. So it started there. And then you had Paris. And then it all changed, because then it became even tougher. You had 130 people killed, where you have the toughest gun laws anywhere in the world. Paris has probably, and France, has probably the toughest gun laws in the world. There are no guns, except for the bad guys. And this sleazebag, who the press would always say, remember the name, right? The press would say great things, like he's Robin Hood. The press would say wonderful things. We're looking for him. They called him a mastermind. The mastermind. What's the mastermind? Put a few people in there, start shooting people. There's nothing. What's the mastermind? This gun laws. I called him the guy with the dirty hat, low IQ, a terrible guy. Now, they got him. They got him. But the press is building him up. And then they wonder why our youth is being radicalized. And ISIS and others are using our internet. We invented the internet. ISIS is using it to radicalize our kids. And our kids are leaving and coming back. One thing with me, if they leave and they leave to fight for ISIS, they're not coming back. I don't care. They're not coming back. So We're going to strengthen our border. We're going to have a really strong border. We're going to build the wall. We're going to build the wall. You know who's paying for the wall, right? Mexico. Now, look, I have a great relationship with Mexico. I have a great relationship with the Mexican people, with Hispanics. In Nevada, I'm leading in the polls with the Hispanics. I'm going to do great with Hispanics because I'm going to bring jobs back from China and all sorts of countries that have taken our jobs. They have stripped us of our jobs. Like we're babies, like taking candy from a baby, they have stripped us of our jobs. You know, interestingly, New Hampshire, you have been a big victim. And in this case, it wasn't so much China. You look at NAFTA, you look at some of the things that happened to here. I look at these factories that are empty. I look at plants that are now senior citizen housing. And that's wonderful, senior citizen housing, but somebody has to have the job. You need the jobs back. Our country has lost millions and millions of jobs to other countries. And now we're losing companies. You look at corporate inversions. You look at what's happening. Corporate inversions, it's unbelievable. Pfizer, great company. They're very good with taking care of politicians. A great company. They get what they want. Remember this. The drug companies have tremendous power, whether it's Pfizer, Johnson & Johnson. The interesting thing, Pfizer's leaving with all their power. And they're leaving thousands and thousands of great jobs behind because the taxes are too high and because they can't get their money back into the country. There's trillions of dollars outside of the United States right now. I talk to these politicians that I'm against. They don't even know what the hell I'm talking about. They don't know. You ask them about corporate inversion. They don't even know what it is. But what happens is companies are now leaving our country because the taxes are so ridiculous. We're the highest taxed country in the world, okay? And they're leaving. And great companies, Pfizer, great company. Others just announced they're leaving. And they're going to leave. You can't stop. You can try and get them to stop. They'll find ways. You know, these great lawyers, these great Wall Street lawyers, believe me, they'll find ways around it. They're leaving. And they're leaving jobs behind. And tremendous. You're talking about hundreds of thousands of jobs behind. And it's happening more and more. You know, it's an interesting thing. We have a president that can't get anybody to do anything. So he signs, you know, executive orders. And country wasn't supposed to be that way. But he signs executive orders because he can't get, he doesn't get people into the Oval Office, into offices, into something, and do something right. But make great deals. Make deals that everybody's happy with. The way the country was supposed to work. He doesn't do that. He doesn't do that. So here's the deal where our corporations and corporations within this country have $2.5 trillion outside of the country. They want to bring it back. I happen to think the number could be $5 trillion. It's a massive amount of money. If it's brought back into the country, it's going to create work. It's going to create jobs. They're going to build, right? Right? Now, here's the problem. The Democrats agree. The Republicans agree. The liberals agree. The conservatives agree. Everybody wants the money brought back. They can't make a deal. The reason they can't make a deal is we don't have a leader. All it needs, I'm telling you, if I'm in the room 1 hour with the leaders, I get it done. 1 hour. 1 hour. 1 hour, I get it done. So the inversion is that now corporations say they're tired. They've been waiting for years. They have billions and billions of dollars outside of the country. They can't bring it back. So they are actually going out to get their money. You believe this? And everybody in Washington agrees that we should allow them to bring it back. It would be so, that's one of the easy ones. You know, it's one thing when you have the Republicans and the Democrats and they disagree on lots of different things. And you can understand, I'll get them to agree. You're right. Where's my, I'll get them to agree. But they disagree on a lot of things, and you can understand it. But that's the thing, inversion. That's the thing they agree on, and they can't get it done. So, Washington is gridlocked. Nothing happens. And nothing good is going to happen if you folks vote in more of these politicians. These politicians don't have it. They're all talk. They're no action. I don't give a damn. If it doesn't work for me, I have this great company. I built this incredible company. I'll go back. I'll be hit in the face with a beautiful saltwater wave and one of my resorts. It's okay. It's okay. But you know what? I want to do this. A lot of people have said, why do you do this? Why? I do it because I want to make America great again. It's so much more important. No, it's true. It's true. Even my kids, I have great kids, Ivanka, you know, Don, Eric, and I have great executives. And frankly, you know, somebody said, well, you built a really great company. And I did. You take a look at, you know, when I did the filing, everyone said, well, he'll never run. Then I ran. He'll never sign Form A. That's where you sign your life away. I signed it. They said, I think he's going to run. Then they said, but he'll never put in his financials because maybe he's not as rich or successful as people think. I put in my financials. They thought that maybe I'd ask for extensions because you're allowed 45-day extensions forever for the rest of your life. You never have to put in it. You could have so many extensions. I told my accountants, they're very expensive. It cost me a lot of money to do almost 100 pages, the biggest one ever filed by a factor of many times, right? I told my accountants, I want it done before 30 days. You get 30 days to put them in, but then you can have extensions for the rest of your life, okay? And some of these politicians, they filed one page, and they've asked for extensions, okay? So I said, I want to do it before the 30 days because I don't, because a lot of the pundits said, well, maybe he'll ask for extensions and it'll go on past the election. So I put them in and they went down and they looked. And the company is a massive, I built a great company. Very low debt, tremendous cash flow. And believe me, if those numbers weren't good, I wouldn't be running right now because I wouldn't. And that's why a lot of people said, I'm a private person. They don't know what the hell I have. Nobody knows what I have. But I filed this document done by the best accounting firms in Washington, the best law firms in Washington, everything right down to the way it's supposed to be. And you know what happened? The press went down. They were dying to see this, and they couldn't believe it. It was much bigger than anybody ever anticipated. The greatest assets, all everything great, low debt, tremendous cash flow. So what? Here's what happens. I filed it. I probably would have filed it even if I wasn't going to run. Because every once in a while, you like to brag a little bit, I will tell you. But what happened is I filed it, and I'm not saying it in a braggadocious way. It's the kind of thinking that our country needs. We have to make great deals now. We can't continue to go on like this. We can't lose $505 billion a year to China on trade deficits. You can't do it. You can't do it. We can't lose hundreds of billions of dollars to Japan. They send our cars. These cars are pouring in. I went to Los Angeles recently. I saw ships, the biggest ships I've ever seen. They're loaded up with cars from Japan. We give them practically nothing. It's called imbalance. It's all one way. We have people negotiating for us who are political hacks. They're the best political hacks in the world. They get their jobs because they give campaign contributions. Some of them get the jobs because they work hard with politicians, but they don't know anything. Carl Icahn, as an example, he's a great businessman. He endorsed me. Many businessmen have endorsed me. They want to endorse me because they say, Carl said, Trump's the only one that knows what the hell he's talking about. The politicians don't. I mentioned corporate inversion before. They don't even know what the hell the term means. Our companies are leaving us. And we don't do anything about it. And New Hampshire knows it better than anybody because you've already gone through it. But you have, I hate to tell you, you have more companies leaving. We're going to bring the companies back from China. We're going to bring the companies back from Japan. We're going to bring the companies back from, excuse me, Mexico. Mexico is killing us at the border, and they're killing us with trade. Mexico just got the big Nabisco plant from Chicago. It's closing in Chicago. It's moving to Mexico. So what are we not going to eat anymore? Oreos! That's a good thing, not a bad thing. Mexico has many car plants coming. People all, it's like going to become the car capital of the world, Mexico. Ford is building a $2.5 billion plant. In Tennessee, they were all set to build a new plant. All set. And it was all set to go. And then the foreign company that was going to build it announced they're not going to go there. They're going to go to Mexico. It's crazy what we're allowing to happen. All because our leaders are incompetent, okay? They're incompetent. You know, we make deals. I always say, Sergeant Bergdahl, we get a traitor, six people killed looking for him. Six people go out and they look for him, and they were killed. Young, beautiful people, our soldiers. Young, beautiful people, six of them killed. Go out, look for Sergeant Bergdahl. So we get Bergdahl. And by the way, we knew he was a traitor before we made the deal, because we had a general and a colonel go and interview all of the people that he worked with, and they told him what happened. So we knew. It's not even like, oh, gee, we found out later. That I can understand. I would like it, but that I can understand a little bit. This is a case where we get Bergdahl, and they get five killers that they've coveted, that they've wanted for years. And they're taking five, and they're right now back on the battlefield looking to kill everybody, including us, okay? This is what we get. This is the way we make deals. And it can't go on. Can't go on. It can't go on. I think I'm going to do great in New Hampshire. I hope I'm going to do great. I love the people of New Hampshire, but it can't go on. Thank you. Thank you. I love you, too. So we have so many things happening, and we don't have the right people. The migration. I looked at the migration. It's so sad to see. And it is. I have a heart. You know, people don't realize that. I am much warmer than other people, and much warmer. I want to help people. I really do. I want to help people. I want to get rid of Obamacare, get you something great. I want to, but, and you know what? And yeah. But you know what? We have some people that won't be able to live. I mean, they're not going to. We have to help people. Don't we have to help? We're Republicans. Somebody said, Donald Trump proposed helping people that have no. I mean, what are we going to do? Let them die in the street? We can't do it. And Republicans understand that. But we're going to have great plans. They're going to be less expensive. They're going to be much more. I mean, Obamacare is out of control. And how about your deductibles? You have to be dead before you can use them. No, they're so high that unless you have a 14-year slow disease, you're not going to be able to use it. A man told me today from New Hampshire just today, he said he gave it up. He couldn't do it. He couldn't afford it. He's got no coverage whatsoever. He's always had coverage. A lot of people had coverage that they were very happy with. They've given it up, and now they have lousy coverage. All the lies, 28 times about the doctor, right? 28 times. I actually said, why didn't we sue for fraud? Because it was fraud. And by the way, a lot of the Democrats, had they known this, they wouldn't have approved it. It just made it. But they were lied to also. It would have never been approved. But you're going to keep your doctor. All the things that he said were total lies. And if he didn't say that, because they were good phrases. They were false, but they were good phrases. If he didn't say that, they would have never gotten it passed. And believe me, Obamacare is a big, people sort of forgotten. But I find it to be almost tougher. Sometimes the biggest applause I get when I say I'm going to terminate, and we're going to terminate. We're going to terminate and replace it with something great, less expensive and much better. And people really want that. A lot of people forget about the $5 billion website. $5 billion for a website. See, it's all crooked politics. So listen to this. So Medicare, we're going to keep your Social Security. We're going to bring our jobs back. We're going to make our country rich again, and we're going to keep you. You've been paying. You've been paying into your Social Security for years, and now they say we want to cut it, we want to raise the age, we want to do all sorts of things. We're going to bring our jobs back. They've stripped our country of wealth. You know, we had a quarter, last quarter, where we had essentially no growth. So we have more people, we have more trouble, we have far more unemployment, although it isn't reported that way. Look. These unemployment statistics are meant and were devised by politicians so that it looks good. When they say 5.2%, this room wouldn't be packed if it was really 5.2%. I go the other day, I mean, I go to Dallas. We have 21,000 people. I go to Mobile, Alabama. We have 35,000 people. By the way, we get, and I say we, check out the cover of Time magazine last week, the most incredible story. It's about us. It's about all of us, not me. It's about us. I'm like the messenger. I feel like the messenger. That's what I am, is a messenger. But I'm going to be a good. You're going to love your messenger. You're going to love your president. You're going to be so proud of your country again. You're going to be proud. You're going to be proud. No, you'll be proud of your country again. You know, we're going to take back our country. We have to. We can't allow it to go on this way. But I go to Mobile, Alabama, 35,000 people. They're incredible people. They're like you. It's not different. I mean, you're from New Hampshire. They're from Mobile. They love the country. You love the country. We all love the country. We're all doing it for the same reason. We're losing our country, and it'll never be the same. And if we have a Hillary, assuming she makes it past her scandal, which is really a big question. No. Look, you have a situation where General Petraeus and many other people, for doing 5% of what Hillary Clinton did, have been destroyed. And I think I helped him because I've been really pounding. They, on top of everything else, they wanted to take away his rank. They wanted to reduce his rank. And I said, leave General Petraeus alone. It's enough. It's enough. These tough guys in Washington, you know, they're real tough guys. They can't beat ISIS. They can't beat anybody. Afghanistan is going to hell. The Middle East is going down. I've been saying bomb the oil for years, and they haven't done it. They just started after Paris, and they're doing a very gentle bombing because they don't want to pollute the atmosphere. And I'll tell you what, that's true. They don't want to bomb the oil because they don't want to pollute the atmosphere. And yet Obama will take Air Force One, an old Boeing 747 with the old engines, and spew crap into the atmosphere as he goes to Hawaii and stays for almost 3 weeks playing golf and then comes back in the same plane. And then he'll have a news conference on global warming and talking about the carbon footprint. Give me a break. Give me a break. You know, I told somebody today, I love golf, and I have some of the greatest golf courses in the world. I own Doral, I own some of the great, one of Turnberry in Scotland, where they have the British Open, some of the greatest British Opens in the history of golf. I mean, some of the great, Jack Nicklaus against Tom Watson. They say the Duel in the Sun, right, folks? The Duel in the Sun, the greatest tournament ever played was at Turnberry, the Duel in the Sun, Jack Nicklaus, Tom Watson. So I have the greatest stuff. But you know what? And I love golf. But if I were in the White House, I don't think I'd ever see Turnberry again. I don't think I'd ever see Doral again. I own Doral in Miami. I don't think I'd ever see many of the places that I have. I don't ever think I'd see anything. I just want to stay in the White House and work my ass off, make great deals, right? Who's going to leave? Who's going to leave? You know, I'm getting to Pennsylvania Avenue, though, one way or the other. You know that. Now, I hope I'm going to be through the White House, but I'm building a building right down the road that's also on Pennsylvania Avenue. So, the old post office. Now, you talk about deal-making. I brought it up today, I think, for the first time. So, the old post office, built in 1880. The old post office is incredible. It's on front. It's a whole block on Pennsylvania Avenue, best location, right between the Capitol building and the White House. Everybody wanted it. Hyatt, very close contributors to Obama. Everybody, Sheridan, Hilton, everybody wanted one of the hottest. It's run by the GSA, General Services. They're the landlord for the United States. And by the way, very, very good people and very, very good professionals. Well, it's because they chose me, but they are, honest. If they didn't choose me, I don't think I'd be saying that probably. But the truth is they are very good. They're excellent. So what happened is I put it in. And I work with Ivanka. Has anyone heard of Ivanka? And she's terrific. And we put it in, and a plan was to build a great, take this old post office, which is no longer used and has been sitting for years and years, like 30 years, really, and take it and convert it into one of the world's great hotels. And other people, many hotel companies bid. It was the hottest, from what I hear, let's say one of, because there's so many people back there, if there was one hotter, but I doubt it, just about the hottest property in the history of the General Service Administration. They bid it out. And we came up with a great plan for a fantastic hotel. It'll be one of the great hotels of the world. And by the way, I have to tell you this. It's 2 years ahead of schedule. It's opening. Listen to this. It'll open in September of this year. Isn't that convenient? I said, we have to open it before the big day. So we're going to be opening in September of this year. We're actually, I mean, the limit was 2 years, but we're actually about a year and a half ahead of schedule, which you don't hear. When was the last time you heard about a government project? Well, we love the tunnel in Boston, don't we, folks? That was 20 years late and about $4 zillion over budget. So here's the story. I'm under budget and ahead of schedule by a lot. Isn't that nice? Wouldn't that be nice? Wouldn't that be nice? But think in terms, we want to negotiate. We need deals, right? We need great deals with trade. We have to, you know, look, they're buying a new Air Force One. $3 billion. They're spending $3 billion. I didn't want to bring it up because if I win, I'm going to be the one to use it, right? So I sort of didn't want to bring it up, but tonight I bring it up for the first time. Do you think I could make a better deal than $3 billion for an airplane? I think maybe just a little. Oh, I know so much about airplanes. When I heard $3 billion, I said, ooh. I said, let's buy some of that Boeing stock. That's a lot. So everybody wanted it. Hyatt, the Pritzker family, is Obama's biggest supporter. Just about, from Chicago. Nice family, good family. They wanted it for Hyatt. Everybody wanted it. Who got it? Trump. How the hell does Trump get the most valuable asset in the GSA, the most sought-after asset in the GSA? I got it for a similar price. I didn't pay. It's not a question of pay. I got it for a similar price. Get the greatest asset in the GSA, most coveted asset. I got it. How the hell do I get it in the Obama administration? It's called negotiation. I wouldn't make a deal like $150 billion to Iran and we get nothing, okay? I would have said, I want my prisoners back and your hostages. I want them back before we even start. And they would have said no. And I would have said very simply, guess what? That's right. You know. I said, bye-bye, right? We leave the room. We double up the sanctions. Within 48 hours, they call us. They say, you've got your prisoners. Then what do? I go back into the room. I say, and my father always used to say, son, you've got to take the lumps out. He thought every once in a while I was too tough. Take the lumps out. Be soft. Be a little bit like Jeb Bush every once in a while. Soft. Okay. Everyone. Oh, it's okay. He said, son, take the lumps out. So I wouldn't say, I want to get the prisoners back. Now they land. Now we call them. Okay, we're ready to negotiate now. Thank you for releasing our prisoners, okay? Again, 100% they give them back because you have to ratchet it up. Now we go back. I don't want to give them $150 billion. The biggest problem I have with if I win is that they have this $150 billion that they're giving to everybody but us, by the way. They're buying planes from Airbus, 118 airplanes from Airbus. They're buying missiles from Russia. They're in Italy buying. They're buying from everybody but us, right? So my father would say, take the lumps out. So I go. And I'd say the following. I'm sorry. We can't give you the $150 billion. We have a country that's bust. The country has no money. We owe $9 trillion. We're going to have 19. We owe $19 trillion. We're going to owe $21 trillion. We have no money. I'm sorry. They're going to go nuts, right? 2-3 days later, they'll forget about it. Come on, let's negotiate. And you negotiate a deal. I wouldn't have ever paid $150 billion. But these politicians have no clue. A guy like Kerry, I mean, this guy, do you think he read The Art of the Deal? A guy like Kerry, now think of it. A guy like Kerry, he never walked from that negotiation once. In Iran, they were dancing in the streets, calling us stupid people. They were celebrating the deal before we even signed it. They were saying what a great deal it is before we even signed it. Everybody was saying what a great negotiator the guy on the other side of the table, and he is. You know, the Persians are great negotiators. But they're all saying what a great negotiator is. He was like a hero. We hadn't even signed the deal yet. Wouldn't you say if you saw all this happening and you're the negotiator on our side, you say, let's walk. We're looking bad. The deal is stupid. And then what happens? Then what happens? So now the deal is done. The money's about ready to pass. And they catch 10 wonderful, young, beautiful sailors that have a problem with the engine. And instead of saying, let's get it fixed up, ba, 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 on your way, they bring them in, they drop them to the begging position on their knees, hands up, guns at their head, and a rough guy, you heard that voice, right? that wasn't a nice person, roughing them up. And what do? We're so, we apologize. It was such a humiliating situation. And they would have never given the sailors back, but they're not stupid people. They're very smart people, much smarter than our people, much smarter than our negotiators, by a factor of about 200. We would have never gotten the sailors back, except for one thing. The money was going to start passing 2 days after they got captured. So we got them back. We were humiliated as a country, and we gave them the money like nothing happened. We're led by stupid, stupid people, okay? Stupid people. So this has been an amazing journey for me. I've never done this before. I've never been a politician before. I never run for office. These guys, they run. They keep coming to me. One of them came up to me about 3 weeks ago after one of the debates. He came, "You said that Mexico's going to pay for the wall." They won't pay for the wall. How can you say that? I said, of course they're going to pay for the wall, 100%. They make a fortune on us. The wall is peanuts. They don't even think you can build a wall. I said, let me tell you, 2,000 years ago, China built the Great Wall of China. It's 18,000 miles long. They did it before Caterpillar tractors were. Now, of course, China would never use Caterpillar tractors. Why would they use them? Unless they built the plants, by the way, on Chinese soil. So China bid 2,000 years ago. They built a wall that is, this is a serious wall, right? I'm looking at him. You know about that wall. That's a serious wall. So we need 1,000 miles. Okay, 1/13. We need 1,000 miles because it's 2,000 miles, but you have a lot of natural barriers, a lot of good stuff that stops. So we need 1,000. And I have these politicians tell me, you can't really build a wall. Do you know they wanted to build a wall 15 years ago? And they couldn't do it because they couldn't get their environmental impact study approved. Did you know that? Because there were snakes or turtles or toads or something. It's true. No, it's true. You look it up. A lot of the people that are now against the wall, including some of the Democrats, check Hillary, by the way, check. They wanted the wall, but they couldn't get it done. They couldn't get an environmental impact statement approved. Can you believe it? Now you have China in the South China Sea. They're building a military base. They're creating an island right smack in the middle of the ocean. They're creating an island. They have the biggest excavators you've ever seen. They're ripping the shit out of the sea, right? And they're building runways and airports. They're building forts. Do you think they got an environmental impact study? You think? Our country's in trouble. Our country's in trouble. So, we're going to fix it. 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 We're going to have strong borders. We're going to have the wall. We're going to have strong, strong borders. We're going to have tremendous trade deals. I have these guys and women. I have these people that are the best in the world. They're the best business people in the world. I know them all. I know the great ones. I know the bad ones. I know the overrated ones. You have people that you think are great, that they're totally overrated. I happen to be underrated, by the way. But that's okay. It's good to be. It's very good to be underrated. That's why when they looked at my statement, they said, I think this guy's been underrated. I know the greatest in the world, and we're going to use them. We're not going to use the hacks anymore. We're not going to use Carolyn Kennedy in Japan to talk about cars. What the hell? She's a very nice person. You know why she's a nice person? Because my daughter Ivanka likes her. When my daughter likes her, that's good. That doesn't mean I want her negotiating with Japan on cars, okay? So some of these people are terrible human beings. Some of these people are horrible. You wouldn't ever, this beautiful woman up here, you would never, ever have dinner with some of these people, although they're very rich. You might have dinner with them, actually. You might. Would you? Does money matter that much? She says, no. I'll bet you would, but no, I'm okay. No, these are people that in many cases are horrible people. Who cares? I want the best. We're going to have the greatest negotiators in the world negotiating this from now on. We're not going to let Mexico steal all our businesses. And this has been going on for years. I mean, you look at New Hampshire. This has been going on for years. It's not going to happen anymore, folks. We're going to bring businesses back. We're going to have businesses. We're going to have businesses that used to be in New Hampshire that are now in Mexico come back to New Hampshire, and you can tell them to go themselves. Because they let you down and they left. We want the businesses that stayed. I know a lot of businesses up here, and I've toured a lot of businesses up here. These are great people. They could have left, and they want to stay. They want to stay. They're fighting to stay. It's hard. We're the highest taxed nation in the entire world. It's hard for them to stay, and they stay. Those are the ones we have to cherish and love. These are the people that are great. But you're going to have people come back now. My tax proposal cuts the hell out of taxes for the middle class, for business. We go from the highest tax nation in the world to a nation that's got pretty low on the taxes, okay? Pretty low on the list. But the middle class has been abandoned by our country. They built the country. The middle class has been abandoned. The vets have been abandoned. The vets are going to be taken care of the way they should be. Where's Al? Where's Al? Where's Al? My Al. There's my Al. Al is, I call him the ultimate vet, and Al loves me, right? You better love me, right? This wouldn't it be terrible if he said, no, Mr. Trump, I don't love you. Al, put your hand up. Go ahead, say it again, Al. Say it in the mic. You have a mic for a reason, Al.
This mic on. All right. I just know what you're going to do for vets. That's why you got 50% support.
I know. I know. I got to tell you, this man is always there, and he goes to others also, and he goes to other people that are running, and he doesn't, he said he gave up. He would go to everything. All he cares about is that the vets are taken care of. I love this guy. Special, special guy. We're going to take care of our vets. Do you know the vets sometimes wait 5 days, 6 days in a waiting room for a simple prescription or a simple something, a procedure? And sometimes they die. They die waiting. The stories. Thousands and thousands. You wouldn't believe it's possible. Thousands and thousands of vets die waiting to see a doctor. It's not going to happen. It's right. It's not going to happen anymore, folks. We're going to take care of our vets. We're not even talking about money. The fact is that if you look at the money that we squander and steal, take a look at Arizona, what's going on with the VA in Arizona. It's a disgrace. The money that's stolen, the corruption is unbelievable. It's all over the country. Our vets are going to be taken care of. Our military is going to be rebuilt. So we're going to do a lot of things. We're protecting our Second Amendment, big league, big league. We're getting rid of Common Core. We're going to bring education to the local level. You know, they're chipping away at your Second Amendment. Every time you see something, they're chipping and chipping. If in California, where you had the two that got married, these two people, oh, wonderful people, marriage, she probably radicalized him. Who the hell knows how it happened? Maybe he radicalized her. I doubt it. But they go out, they worked with a group of people that gave them parties, gave them their baby shower, gave them so. They walk in, they killed them, 14 people dead, something wrong. Then you have in Paris, and a lot of things happened in Paris, a lot of things changed. And people liked me more after Paris, which is terrible in a way, but people liked me more after Paris because they want somebody that understands what the hell is going on. And I get it. In Paris, they have 130 people. Killed, dead. If we had some people, and by the way, many, many people, many, many people lying in a hospital, so gravely wounded, there are going to be many more deaths. They walk in, boom, 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 130 people, horribly hurt people, lives destroyed people, if they don't die. If there were guns on the other side, if there was some of, like, you, that guy right over there, the tall guy with the red hat, if we had some people on the other side that were being shot at with guns wrapped around their ankle or their waist, where the bullets could go in the other direction, you wouldn't have had the carnage that you had. They had nothing. Remember what I said at the beginning. No, no. Remember what I said at the beginning. The toughest gun laws in the world, Paris and France. The toughest in the world. Same thing in California. If you had people that had a couple of guns over there, so we're going to protect our Second Amendment. We're going to protect it. We're not going to let people chip away. We're not letting. Just in finishing up, education is so important. So I told you, we're going to get rid of Common Core, right? Common Core is Washington, Department of Education. So we're ranked as a country number 30 in the world. We're ranked as a country cost per pupil number one in the world. So we pay the most in the entire world for education by a factor that's so high that the second place contender, and by the way, it's Norway, Sweden, Denmark, China, and on and on. And then as you start getting up, we end up with third world countries that come before us. Pretty sad, right? We're 30. We have third world countries that have better educational systems than the United States of America. Now think of this. So we're number one in cost per pupil, and we're number 30, we're at the bottom of the pack. Wouldn't it be nice, okay? And I relate it to something else, like Jeb Bush. He spent $100 million, and he's nowhere. He's like at the bottom of the pack. And the only reason I even bring him up is he does so many commercials of me. They're so negative. They're so I didn't even know I was that bad a person. Honest. No, they're so negative. But they can't be that negative because every time they go on, my poll numbers go up. It's crazy. Oh, it's. But think of it. For this campaign, I have spent less money than anybody else, and I'm number one in every poll nationally, right? And by the way, I'm number one in New Hampshire. Will you please keep me there? This is ridiculous. It's ridiculous. Keep me there. Oh, you'll be so happy. If you do, you'll be so proud of that decision. Believe me. Believe me. You're going to be so proud. So, I spent the least, and I have the best result. Wouldn't it be great if the United States could do that, not only with education, with other things? We spend the least and we have the best. We spend the least and we have. Wouldn't that be fantastic? Wouldn't that be great? So we're going to start winning again. We're going to win on trade with these other countries that are ripping us off. We're going to win on health care. We're going to win with the military. We're going to knock the shit out of ISIS. Going to knock the shit out of it. We're going to win on health care. We're going to win on every aspect, everything we do. We're going to have so many victories. We're just not going to, we just can't fail anymore. We don't have the option to fail anymore. We have a country that's a debtor nation, and we don't have the option. So I just want to tell you, this is an important evening. This is a great group. I've done five of these today in different forms. Do you think this is fun? Do you think this is fun? I've had more meetings today. I've had great meetings, though. I met with your police department in Manchester. I mean, what we're doing, you like them, right? I met with police. By the way, the police, they do such a great job. You talk about. And we have to honor our police. Okay. So it's very important. February 9th, you got to get out and vote. Don't think we're going to win. Just go out. You got to get out and vote. No matter where you are, no matter how you feel, I don't give a damn. You got to go out. You got to get out of bed. You got to vote. We've got to create a mandate. We have to create victory. And I'm telling you, I give you my word, we will make this country, this great, great country, we will make it better and stronger and smarter than ever, ever, ever before. Thank you. I love you.